Oh man, folks, Backlash 2018. Can you believe it? Raw and SmackDown, the same show for the first time since like Greatest Royal Rumble, so not that long ago. They couldn't even commit to the single brand pay-per-view experiment in this iteration of the brand split for near the length they did in the first one. Come on, like a year and a half tops is how long they held it for. Kind of ridiculous, guys. Come on, up your game a bit. Let's move on. Let's get this over with. The pre-show match was Bayley versus Ruby Riott. Backstage earlier in the pre-show, Bayley asked Sasha to accompany her to ringside, and Sasha balked since Bayley wasn't there for her last week. You know, I hate to say it, but Sasha actually made a good point for once here in this feud. And honestly, speaking of feud, how are we still in this mode of when will this relationship finally, you know, explode? Will they get back together? It's like I feel this friendship between Bayley and Sasha should have blown off at least four times but up to now, and how it hasn't up to this point is crazy. By the time it finally does happen, nobody's going to care. Liv Morgan on the apron provides the distraction. Ruby wins with the Riott kick. The numbers game at play here, and so Ruby wins the match. It was a solid kickoff match, but you know, as per usual, it does not count toward my score. In the first of two interbrand matches on the evening, the show officially begins for the Intercontinental title as Seth Rollins defends against The Miz. And, you know, I will just say it right now, best match of the night by far. No one can top this. It was just a great way to start the show. Unfortunately, it went all downhill from here. But I will say these two, I love when these two wrestle each other. Their styles complement each other so well here. And you wouldn't think they would, but I think The Miz is kind of a chameleon. He can't work well with a lot of different people. And Seth is very much in the same way. A massive frog splash by Seth at one point in the match, like from like three quarters of the ring, and the height is just amazing. Rollins blasts his knee into the turnbuckle on the outside, and Miz gets him right in the figure four, and I thought the match was gonna end right there. Honestly, this match went about a half hour, maybe about 25 minutes or so, and this was just like, at this point in the match, I thought we were gonna get to the finish at some point, but no, it went a lot longer than that. There's a couple points where, you know, the Miz keeps working Rollins' leg. Rollins, you know, I've talked about this before on Who Wore Better, how Rollins is very selective in when he sells his knee, and especially, you know, this time last year when he was like fresh off his knee injury and everything, he was selectively selling it then. He's doing more of it here, and that's been an ongoing problem. He does sell it a few times here at certain points, but then there's times he's just jumping around and everything. He doesn't feel a thing, apparently. Miz hits him with two skull-crushing finales. Seth kicks out of both of them, which the crowd went nuts for. Who kicks out of two skull-crushing finales? Roman, maybe, but, you know, not Seth Rollins. This was crazy to see that happen. There. Seth wins with the stomp and retains. What an opener. I love this match. You know, kicking to a whole other gear after the Rollins hurt his knee on the turnbuckle on the outside and just went to just, it was constantly dramatic and suspenseful from there. And yeah, I thought after that match, this is going to be a tough one to top, and I was not wrong. Nia Jax defends the Raw Women's title against Alexa Bliss here. Nia's offense got a little one-dimensional in this match, I noticed. It was just a lot of the same kind of slams over and over again. I mean, Alexa was selling like death for her in this match, but I think the match overall was pretty competently done. I don't think it was a bad match per se, but I think I just started to notice, like, I was getting kind of tired of what Nia was doing when she was on the offensive. At one point, Nia gets dumped over the top rope and onto the floor, almost like hits her head on the stairs. Like, she was pretty close to making a very scary looking fall, and Bliss hits the DDT on the steps. I would have loved it if the finish were Bliss outsmarting herself and being unable to pick up Nia and get her into the ring. She's just dead weight because she's so much bigger than Alexa. I thought that would have been a brilliant finish. Alexa goes for Twisted Bliss, but Nia gets up and catches her on her shoulder and drops her with a Samoan drop to win and retain the championship. You know, I think there were the one real negative I had with this, one real nitpick with this matchup, there were a few kind of sloppy transitions, especially on the shoulder stuff that Alexa and Nia were doing. But beyond that, I think it was a fine match. I think it told the story that it needed to tell, Alexa being very shrewd and resourceful in the ring, and Nia just overpowering everything and ultimately winning. Then we get this post-match promo in the ring with Nia, and she clearly was fed this script, word for word, you must recite these bullet points, be a star, whatever, bullies are bad, da-da-da-da. And it was just, oh God, it was so bad watching this. The delivery was so bad. A good message, terrible delivery. She just like read it. You could see her eyes moving left to right, visualizing the script in front of her as she was reading it. And then after she finishes her promo, which admittedly has a really cool final line, and I'll get to that, Cole seamlessly transitions into a commercial for the Be a Star program, which is like, ugh, like I just didn't want it. That was such a bad, so transparent. So you're telling me this whole, these last 2 months of Alexa and Nia has boiled down to a giant commercial for the Be a Star campaign? Get the fuck out of here. That was ridiculous. I will say, in a perfect world, I would have just had Nia say the one sentence at the very end.
In the end, a bully always gets their ass kicked.
And if she did that, that would have been perfect. That would have been a perfect, succinct, short and sweet thing just to really tie a little bow on this whole storyline of Alexa bullying Nia, and Nia gets the last laugh, gets the last word in. But yeah, I think big win for Nia. I think it's good to see Alexa kind of move on. I hope she moves on from the title scene at this point, because I'm kind of tired of seeing Alexa dominating the women's scene on Raw and SmackDown for that matter, just constantly being champion. It's good to see a face champion and finally retain a championship for once in the women's division. And hopefully she'll go on and face new challenges. U.S. title match as Jefe Hardy defends against Randy Orton. Lots of outside action in this match early on. Both guys getting their licks in, utilizing their environment. At one point, Orton hits three straight backdrops onto Jeff, onto the barricade, which looks pretty devastating. Some Rusev Day chants during Orton's trademark chin lock here. Orton hits the drape over DDT and goes to the RKO, but Jeff fights out of it, hits the Twist of Fate and the Swanton. Don't you love the ones that don't go quite far enough forward and he just takes all of his weight right on the guy? That always makes me smile when it happens. Jeff wins and retains the title there. It was a good match. Ultimately, nothing special about it. It was a good match between Jeff Hardy and Randy Orton if it was 2008 and they were wrestling then. I think that it's like this is a time capsule of the match from then. In today's environment, I think it's good to go a little, you know, I hate to use the phrase old school for a match from like 10 years ago, but that's, you know, it's a different style. They wrestle, they came up from a very different style that what you see younger wrestlers from today's era utilize. And so this was a match from that era, and it was good, it was fine, but it wasn't anything to write home about. We get a musical performance from Elias, and he is over like Rover in Newark, New Jersey. He gets mad because the fans won't shut their mouths. He gets ready to leave. At one point, he's like pivoting on one foot and getting the yay boos for each step he's taking, which I think is hilarious. Then the New Day interrupt. They want to do a joint concert. So Elias says, script, JoJo, start from the top. So JoJo controls the lights, apparently. She's about to start it over again. Then Aiden English and Rusev come out. So it's Rusev Day. Elias wants to start again. Then No Way Jose interrupts. Okay, by now you've completely gone off the rails in terms of the theme. We're not doing like a musical performance anymore. It's like No Way Jose's dancing. He's not singing. He's not playing instruments. What's going on? Also, Titus, Apollo Crews, and Dana Brooke and Breezango are with them as well. Elias wants to start again, then Bobby Roode interrupts. He teleports into the ring, hits Elias with a glorious DDT, not selling the throat at all from last week. Everyone but Rusev and English dance their way back up the ramp. You know, people are going to trash this segment. I think that talking segments, just purely promo bits in pay-per-views, can be kind of hit and miss, mostly miss. But yeah, I was entertained with this one. And looking back in hindsight of all the things that go on in this show, I kind of look back at this segment as like, this was a good moment. This was like, still happy times were in our future. It was what we thought after watching this segment here. Big Cass makes his in-ring return after injury and takes on Daniel Bryan here. We get a We Want Enzo chant early on. I'm like, really, do you? Cass asserts his size and his strength for the bulk of the match here, but Daniel uses his resourcefulness to avoid the kill shot. It's always fun trying to see how often he can avoid taking a straight back bump in this matchup here. He fights to get Cass into the yes lock. He finally locks it in after some cross face shots, and Cass almost immediately taps out. So Bryan wins the match, but then he's beat down by Cass after the bell, and Cass just lays into him and just lays him out. And that's the end of the segment. The match itself was nothing special. I mean, Cass warned us. It wasn't going to be a five-star match. He warned you, folks. I'm not saying every Daniel Bryan match from here on out has to be a barn burner, but this match just wasn't doing it for me. I think that these two, as much as I like both of them individually, this match and this feud isn't really doing it for me. As much as I want to see Cass succeed, I believe this angle is kind of a no-win situation for him. I think he needs to be put in more of like, I mean, as much as I think they want to kind of strap a rocket to him and push him as the next big player, I think he needs to get his feet wet with more like rudimentary feuds with lower card guys before moving right up for Daniel Bryan, you know? Like, I think that's my thought on it. The SmackDown Women's Champion Carmella gets a bit of a hometown reception in her home state of New Jersey as she defends against Charlotte Flair. The crowd is kind of dead for this one for the most part, though. Lots of slow-mo moments in this match, lots of holes. I did pop though for Carmella's counter out of a roll pinfall attempt into the Code of Silence. That was kind of a cool little counter there. Charlotte goes for the moonsault, lands on her feet, tweaks the leg. Carmella kicks the leg and pins her to retain the championship. This match, this was lame. This is a bad, underperforming match. I didn't care about this match nearly as much as, say, Alexa Nia, but, you know, to this match's credit, at least it wasn't a commercial for an anti-bullying campaign. It's a no DQ match as AJ Styles defends a WWE Championship against Shinsuke Nakamura. I've yet to mention this in my videos prior to this, so I'll just say it right now. I'm officially in love with Shinsuke's new theme. It took me some time to kind of like marinate for a bit on this, but the more I listened to it and when I saw his entrance, I think it really, really clicked with me when I saw his entrance during the GER a few weeks ago. Just like the way the song plays out and everything, and the way Shinsuke moves to it, I think it's great. I think it's just an awesome new wrinkle to add to his heel persona. Anyway, after some regular wrestling early on, the action does spill to the outside. The call of the night from Tom Phillips, where he says,
"Pleasure all over the face of Nakamura."
Phrasing.
Shinsuke grabs a chair on the outside, but he can't hit AJ with it. He goes for the Kinshasa moments later, but then AJ throws it just right at Shinsuke's leg, and then it deflects, it ricochets, and hits AJ in the face, and he is now comes with battle damage, has a big cut on his cheek, so he's bleeding for the rest of the match. Styles clash attempt, but Shinsuke gets out of it, hits the Kinshasa, and then AJ finally hits one of his own. Finally, then we get a moment where a wormhole opens in the universe because we get a double dick kick city. Both guys kick each other in the balls. They fall down. I pop for that one. I gotta admit, that was a great moment. I wish they could pick up and do more from there, but unfortunately we get kind of a lame finish where it's a double count out and it's a draw. Boo! Kind of a crap finish for a match that's billed as no DQ. I know that the language doesn't say no count out as well, so you know that's how they get around it, but still, I mean, come on, it's implied. So they have chairs, but you can kick through the balls, but if you lay down for a long enough time, then the match is over. Come on. The match, I think, was probably the best one in the series. I think better than Mania, better than the Gurr. The finish, though, was worse, I think, than Gurr, to be perfectly honest. I mean, for it to have that apex of like, oh my god, double low blow, and then it ends in the draw, that was very disappointing. But overall, before that, I think it was a strong match. But yeah, the booking of that finish, and just the way they've been booking this feud in general, like, I've been a fan of like heel Shinsuke and constantly hitting the low blows and everything, but it's like, they really don't want to pull the trigger on Shinsuke winning the title, do they? Like, this is going to prolong for their match at Money in the Bank. This is the kind of thing, the kind of feud where you wish that Extreme Rules were the next pay-per-view and not Money in the Bank. But man, the way they've been booking this feud as it goes on, I feel like, God, how could you cock this up so badly? Moving on, we get Braun Strowman and Do We Love Bobby taking on Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn in a rematch from a few weeks ago on Raw. I don't think anyone cared about this matchup. The crowd didn't care. I certainly didn't care. I don't think the writers did either, because this match just had a complete, just a very confusing finish here. Dissension in the ranks. After the hot tag, when Strowman beats everyone up, Sami tries to escape and does a countout thing, but Kevin says no. Sami tosses Kevin in the ring. KO escapes, throws Sami in. They have a tip. Sami slaps Kevin, then he leaves. Let's KO get to destroyed by Big and Beefy. That's the name I'm calling these two now. Was Kevin even legal? I'm pretty sure Sami was legal in that match, but Kevin takes the fall anyway. Who cares? What the fuck is going on in this thing? And then Sami gets a hit with a running power slam at the end to send everyone home. I mean, not happy, obviously, but I mean, this segment ends on a high note for the faces here. This is easily a match that could have been on Raw. Well, it was on Raw a couple weeks ago. This is a match that didn't need to happen again, honestly. You could have developed the tiff on Raw, and like, of all the storyline progressions in this show, of which there are none except for this moment here with Kevin and Sami, this is pretty tame. Main event time is Roman Reigns takes on Samoa Joe in our last inter-brand matchup. Joe gets things started right away with a big beatdown before the bell rings, a uranage through the announce table onto Reigns before the match officially begins. As the match does kick off and the bell does ring, Joe works Reigns over for the first part of the match. I hear some CM Punk chants. Hoo boy, in for a long night. The crowd is definitely not feeling this matchup here. There's a lot of different chants. I had a crowdsource to figure out what the hell people were saying because I couldn't understand it, but people were saying there's a beat the traffic chant, there's a boring chant, a Rusev Day chant, Natch. There's delete chant, I did make that one out, and a Johnny Wrestling chant near the end as well. So Johnny Wrestling gets chanted both in the Mania main event and in the Backlash main event. Truth be told, I've always enjoyed matches between these two guys because they both have a hard-hitting physical style and they always just like leave it all in the ring. I think makes it more watchable and worthwhile to me. This match was no exception. I think the match itself was high quality. I might be the minority here when I say that, but I did enjoy this match for the most part. I love Joe catching the drive-by attempt into the Coquina clutch. Fucking night of awesome counters. If there's one silver lining to be had in this whole show, there's a lot of really cool counters and even the most mundane matches, which I love. Joe finding all kinds of ways to get the clutch. And this part pissed me off because Reigns is clearly passing out. And, you know, in any other match on Raw or whatever, they would have stopped the match here and Joe would have won. But you see, he suddenly wakes up. You know, they don't even do the arm drop thing. I know if they're not going to do the arm drop gimmick anymore because it is kind of an old school thing and it's kind of dated, then don't have this moment here where the guy's clearly passed out and then in a shoot fight, an MMA fight, they would stop the match. But here he's like, he wakes up and goes, ah! And you can tell the fans are shitting all over it. Kind of a bullshit falsie. Samoa Joe sets up the muscle buster, which we have not seen in a very, very long time, and we don't get to see it tonight because Roman gets out of the way, hits Joe with a spear to win the match. all things considered, except for the finish being a little bullshit, I think it was a very solid match. Roman finally gets a big win after two straight losses to Lesnar at WrestleMania and the Gurr. You know, all things being equal, all finishes being the same, if you're not going to put Rollins and Miz in the main event, then I guess this is the best match you could have put in the main event. The one with the most conclusive, satisfying ending. Honestly, I don't think Joe's going to hurt from this because he'll have a clean slate on SmackDown now. I get why people are mad about it. Honestly, if I wouldn't have had a problem with a finish to this matchup if everything else in this show, say for the opener, were not also shit. I think I would have been happy with this match being as predictable as it was and kind of a straight up, a predictable finish as we saw, if there were more exciting things in the show besides that. My overall grade for Backlash 2018 is going to be a D+ grade. I wanted to give it a C-, that's giving you too much credit. Except for the opener with Rollins and Miz, there was not a real awesome match among them. There were some bad matches, but there were also some just kind of like, okay matches. Like Alexa and Nia wasn't bad. Jeff and Orton, not a terrible match at all. You know, I'm going to admit, I like the Elias segment. And looking back, it's nice to have a bit of levity and goofiness to really kind of remind you it's not all dreary and depressing after all, like the rest of the show was. And I did like the Joe and Roman match up until the finish. And I liked the AJ Shinsuke match up until the finish. I hate the inconclusive finish there, especially for a no DQ match. But Charlotte and Carmella wasn't that great. The finish to the WWE title match was shit. Strowman and Lashley, Kevin Owens and Zayn, that match did not need to happen there. Now you've had two major shows. You've had the Gurr and you've had Backlash now with zero title changes, except for, yeah, the Raw tag titles. I know, whatever. Fuck you. You know what I'm talking about. And zero storyline intrigue, zero advancement, zero big moments. There's no rule saying you have to have X number of title changes in a show or X number of heel or face turns per pay-per-view. But if you don't have any of that across two major shows, then why even running them anymore? Honestly, like, that's the whole point of these pay-per-views, is to drive traffic and eyeballs to the television product. But did anything happen on this show that made you want to watch Raw on Monday or SmackDown on Tuesday? I don't think so. Two of the best matches on this show were interbrand matches you can't follow up on TV because they're on Raw and SmackDown afterwards. You can't follow up on Rollins and Miz. You can't follow up on Joe and Roman. You can't do that. So that wasn't the smartest thing to do. It's like, God, it was a boring show except for the opener. And like I said, I would have been okay with Roman and Joe ending the show the way it was. I would have been fine with it being the exact same if there was literally anything else going on earlier in the show that would have got a pop out of me, like, you know, a title change in Shinsuke AJ or something of that nature. There was just nothing, again, except for the Intercontinental title match. I will always give credit to that. Don't get things confused. I will always say that was the match of the night, probably the best match, one of the better matches of the year, probably, I would say, early contender. But this show is a really bad omen if this is the kickoff of the return of interbrand non-Big Four pay-per-views. I would imagine, I'm still kind of thinking they're still kind of shaking off and still trying to like figure things out after the shakeup, because once they get this out of their system, they can finally, like, you know, move on forth with the storylines they want to tell on the pay-per-views up ahead and just get things going and kind of get a rhythm going across both shows. This is definitely that kind of like growing pains period where they're still kind of settling people after the moves and everything, the call-ups and whatever. So I hate being overly negative on this channel. You know that. I always try and find the silver lining in everything. But man, it's hard to find a lot of positive stuff about this show, except for the ones I've already mentioned. And this was just overall a very poor pay-per-view. Oh, and I've had a few people ask me to include a kind of a who wore better pay-per-view edition based on like which brand did better on these shows now. So I guess I'll try and do a kind of informal one here. I guess Raw did better on this show simply on the merit of Seth Rollins and kicking ass in that opening matchup. And yeah, and Roman Reigns winning in the main event as well. So yay, Raw. Raw to Raw. That's what I have to say about this one. It's not by much, honestly. It's not like a clear landslide. Raw did so much better, but it's basically on the merit of the opening IC title match. Let me know what you guys thought about Backlash in the comment section below, and be sure to give it a letter grade in the gimmick in the upper right hand corner of your screen. Be sure to thumbs up this video if you like it, subscribe to Wrestling With Regret, buy the t-shirts at ProWrestlingTees.com, and check out patreon.com/WrestlingWithRegret for exclusive perks and bonus content. I'm Brian Zane, and I'll see you next time.